Andrew Leung did not do what he is doing, the bill will eventually be passed. Why did he choose such a negative approach, Mr. Yu Siwing? Madam Deputy, on behalf of the six-person group, I speak in support of the third reading of the bill. After the bill is scrutinized and debated, we can see that the opposition camp is opposing to co-location. They are questioning the administration because they don't trust the administration, and they are painting scenarios that will never happen in order to scaremonger the public. However, the public are discerning. In many opinion polls, the majority of respondents supported co-location. There would be facilitation of travel and clearance. This is the world trend. If you think of ways to oppose co-location and smear XRL, you are going against the world trend and it's unrealistic, so you don't have the support of the public. Madam Deputy, when Hong Kong is still arguing about co-location, Macau and Zhuhai are facilitating travelers. At the Zhuhai Macau control points of Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, they are adopting co-location. They are combining the control points of the two places at one place, and there will be no passageway between the control points, whether it is physical check or the e-channels. Travelers will just have to line up once using a valid permit, and they will pass through two gates so that they are cleared for departure and arrival. This shortens the waiting time for clearance. With the Belt and Road Initiative and the Bay Area construction, Hong Kong must integrate itself into this trend of development. The ALG has the responsibility to design realistic and convenient clearance facilities under the principle of one country, two systems. This is the trend. Co-location at WKS of XRL is one such facilitation measure. It is a pragmatic approach under Hong Kong laws. Co-location is nothing new. It was implemented at Shenzhen Bayport. We leased an area on the mainland as the Hong Kong port area to implement Hong Kong laws. Starting from 2007, it has operated for over 10 years. It was very smooth and there was no cross-boundary enforcement, and it is still operating effectively. The same applies to WKS. Part of the area there is leased as an MPA, and when there is reciprocity between the two places, why is it something not good? Many Hong Kong people now live and work or travel to the mainland for leisure. Hong Kong is also an important travel hub for Asia Pacific. Many people transit here, whether they take planes, buses, or vessels, in order to go to the mainland for work or for pleasure. Last year, 60 million people visited Hong Kong. Every year, 80 million Hong Kong people went to the mainland for leisure, for business, for visiting relatives. And the Hong Kong XRL will link up with the mainland high-speed rail network and also the Bay Area Living Circle. There will be more traveling between the two places, and people will ask for more convenience. We should try to shorten the queues for clearance to facilitate citizens and tourists. We can see that the SALG has done a lot in facilitating clearance. Say, for example, if you use the Sky Pier, you will be able to send your luggage beforehand. And also, this can be done at the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge. Liantang Port will be the first one on land where people can drive to the joint clearance building, and they will be able to just pass through that building. The Immigration Department is also actively promoting mutual recognition for e-channels with other countries. Now South Korea, Germany, and Singapore have accepted this. Mr. Dennis Kwok, what is the point of order? I think he has digressed too much. Just now, Yip Kin Yun and myself were talking about the bill, and he said that we digressed. And now he is talking about traveling to other countries. I think you should sit down now. You have raised the point of order. I'm talking about why I support the third reading, and some other people are objecting, and I'm responding to those by citing reasons for supporting the bill. I will come to an end very soon. So whether it is co-location or other facilitation measures, as long as you are people-based and as long as they are lawful and legitimate, we should all support it. The administration should continue to roll out these approaches. And some of you say this should be one-off. Well, this is mentioned by you, right? I think it is short-sighted. You should be more forward-looking. You should actively support innovative new clearance measures.
So that Hong Kong can maintain its position as a transportation hub. I'm sure that it should be people-based. Hong Kong people's interest should be an important point. Co-location is only one of those options. And I ask the opposition not to continue to scaremonger. Dr. Fernando Zhang, I have been listening to the loyalists try to defend the co-location bill. They have spent a lot of time, but they have not touched the core issue. They talk about we are opposed to the co-location. We have made it very clear that we don't oppose to co-location. We oppose to having co-location in the West Kowloon Station in Hong Kong. There can be co-location in Futian because it works in Shenzhen Bay. We opposed to it because of the basic law. Why didn't you mention this? The basic law doesn't say that Hong Kong law cannot be applied on the mainland, but it says that mainland laws cannot apply in Hong Kong. This is a very simple logic. You keep saying that we oppose for the sake of it. This is just slogans. Please stop chanting the same slogans. We oppose to it because it contravenes the basic law. Tell us, Article 18 of the Basic Law states that national laws shall not be applied in Hong Kong. Then tell us why. You think that it can run counter to it. You say, well, NPCSC has made a decision. Well, the NPCSC, you say that NPCSC used a decision to promulgate the basic law, but can you say that the NPCSC is more superior than the basic law? You're saying that NPCSC has the highest constitutional status. That's why they can override the basic law. If that is the case, that you're blindly defending the whole issue, you allow another place to break our law. It is enshrined in the basic law. Does the NPCSC have to abide by it? The laws endorsed by the LegCo. Should legislators abide by these laws? Is it the case that, well, we can break a law that we have endorsed because we are superior? That is impossible, but that is exactly what you are doing. You can't argue with us. If you have reason on your side, if you have logic on your side, bring it on. What they have said, well, the deputy said that she was representing the DAB, which is the biggest party of the loyalists camp. They said that we have been talking about insufficient of time and we have been wasting time, we have been delaying. But you said it yourself. Wong Ting Kuang in 2008, as you said, moved a motion here to implement collocation as soon as possible. That is 2 years ago. When did the administration introduce the bill? 10 years ago, we said that collocation did not work in Hong Kong because of the basic law. At that time, you said it doesn't matter. Even without collocation, the SRL still has benefits. But today, Starry Lee said that you are now turning the SRL into scrap metal. But back then, they said that, well, SRL still brings benefit without collocation. And today you say that without collocation, the SRL will become scrap metal. We say back then that the collocation will contravene the basic law. We asked the administration to come up with a proposal that works. Give us one. But we have never seen one that works. You have been delaying for 10 years. You've been filibustering for 10 years. And then in 28, you came to us with a bill at the end of January. The SRL will commission in summer, in the third quarter. So you gave us less than 3 months to complete the scrutiny. In less than 36 hours, we have to endorse or carry this bill. You call this sufficient time? We gave you 10 years, you did not do anything. And then you turn around and tell us that you gave us 3 months and that's sufficient. And she said, well, this is we say that it's unconstitutional. Then let's continue to deliberate on this. And in the end, she said, well, the MPCSC enjoys a supreme position. Well, that's simple then. You don't need to say anything about the law. You said that you want to uphold the rule of law in Hong Kong. Central government said that they rule by law. And the first person who came out to break the law is the loyalists and the central authority. That's very clear. Our civilization, Hong Kong civilization, is built on the rule of law. We have transparent and open rules. Not like you, that this person has the final say and that person doesn't have to follow procedure. Whatever that person says goes. Well, basic law says that if you want to amend anything, follow the procedure. Go through the whole process. If the MPCSC wants to change it, follow the procedure. And if you want to say, well, I want to bend it the way I like, then you can use the interpretation. But now you don't want to do that. You now tell the world, you tell Hong Kong people that you are not bothered to follow the procedure and the mechanism you have set down. Because whatever I say goes. And, cooperation agreement and a three-step process have no legal basis, but they said it, so they can do it. And they have had it written in the basic law that cannot be contravened, and yet they contravene it. It's not just the case that mainland flouts the law, but you force Hong Kong to flout the law as well. As we all know, that is nothing new when laws are flouted on the mainland. Talk about human rights, suppression and oppression of dissidents. We have seen numerous occasions, but we don't want that to happen in Hong Kong. We don't want to see this bill carry because it breaks our far fundamentals, the rule of law. We oppose to the collocation because we want to uphold one country, two systems. We oppose to the collocation because we think that you have ceded a part of Hong Kong. away. International experience tells us that they would not give up the legal jurisdiction as well as the criminal jurisdiction. Say, for example, Eurostar, France and UK. The boundary, the border is very clear, but now it's in a mess. You have created a monster. This monster is sitting in West Kowloon Station. In West Kowloon, they say that this is mainland territory where mainland laws apply. So the legal jurisdiction has been given to mainland officials. However, so mainland officials will enforce the law. However, there are six reserved matters, but I don't know how you implement it. It's related to insurance, employment, basic electrical or power safety. Frank Chan was from the EMSD. If there are conflicts, whether it's with customers, passengers, mainland officials, if electrical and mechanical staff said this is it's a job that we have to do. Well, but the mainland authority personnel said that no, because it is a relative of ours. So they arrest the Hong Kong personnel. What are you going to do? Well, you have added another layer. You don't blatantly say that this is not Hong Kong territory. As a result, that international convention will have to apply there. That means in one single location, there are three different tiers of legal system. You have to be accountable to international court, to UN, and to local courts, because there are six reserved matters. But as a whole, the mainland laws apply. It's a complete chaos. It is a moving boundary. It's something new. It's never been seen before. The boundary is mobile. It follows the train to arrive to the West Kowloon Station. So on the train is mainland territory. However, there is also a teleportal shift, because at one point, the same train, which a second before is mainland territory, becomes Hong Kong territory. So this is a mobile boundary that can change in a second. Well, if you're so scared of refugees, illegal immigrants, that person only has to hide in the train. When the train moves to Shek Kong, then that person and the train enters Hong Kong territory. And that can be like a smuggling. So the goods smuggle doesn't have to go past any customs clearance or boundary control points, and it enters Hong Kong. When it comes to public health, well, if it is a clear border control, then we know that both sides will remain vigilant against infectious disease, say, for example, SARS. We guard against infectious disease coming to Hong Kong, and mainland sides do the same. Well, if we know that there are patients infected with an infectious disease on the train, can we stop the train? We can't. You have to make it clear. That means that patient with infectious disease will go all the way into the heart of Hong Kong. How do we control the spread of infectious illness in the perspective of public health? If there is a clear border, it's very true because it will stop there. Both sides will do their work. That's why we want to move amendments. If you want to have this limited to CIQ, don't deal with anything else, but you refuse. The entire legal jurisdiction is handed over on a silver plate to the mainland side. You have created a monster. There is information. The information is opaque. Nothing over 10 years, and all of a sudden you gave us something. The entire loyalist camp, Mrs. Regina Ip, everyone signed up in the Bills Committee. You use every resource available to distort our rules of procedure, to abuse your power. You don't allow it to ask questions or say anything.
All information has been withheld. You won't tell us how much you are losing. You won't tell us how many passengers you expect. If the XLL suffers losses, we don't know if the MTR Corporation would ask the taxpayers to fill the void. As a responsible lawmaker, what can we do then to oppose it? We should not allow an illegal and unconstitutional bill to be passed. Mr. Kwai Kang, I speak in support of the third reading of the bill. I would like to rebuke the views of the opposition. And before that, I stress that to maximize the efficiency or benefits of the XLL, collocation must be arranged, and this is a popular option. According to past polls, more than 50 support was obtained, so there's certainly reason to support the arrangement. Without collocation, the XLL would be rendered obsolete, and this would jeopardize Hong Kong's role in defending its role in the region, and our future participation in the Bay Area would also be affected. The losses would be too numerous to count. Onboard clearance is not feasible, and clearance at Futian is also a malicious suggestion, because the real purpose is to stifle the XLL. Many members talked about the jurisprudence and the basic law. I must stress that according to Article 1 of the basic law, the Hong Kong XLL is an inalienable part of the People's Republic of China. So the cession, the claims of land cession is against Article 1. Land cession has to do with Hong Kong independence, but those members are being unconstitutional. Apparently, they want to defend the basic law, but they are damaging the basic law, and they are hiding behind the basic law. If you feel that the basic law and the legal system is the major point of controversy or contention, there was no need to propose the 24 amendments. All the amendments did not have real objectives. Mr. Gary Fan was very honest because he talked about the anti-XLL sentiments, and he wanted to secure those votes. And at the end of the day, they are trying to extend or continue the anti-XLL sentiments, and they are standing in the way of commissioning. There is just no other explanation. The opposition said that they didn't have enough time to speak, but everyone can see that there were constant quorum calls. They were filibustering in wasting time, and they said they have no time to speak. This doesn't, that doesn't make sense. In the second reading debate, Ms. Tanya Chen moved a motion to adjourn, and the duration of time was affected. And in the motion to adjourn, most opposition members already voiced their views, and they all had 15 minutes. And even with 15 minutes each, they did not they could not finish what they wanted to say unless they had the intention to filibuster. President, in the previous term of LegCo, when dealing with the for funding proposals for the XLL, he was very angry. At the time, Mr. Wong Kok-heng asked the opposition members not to use the XLL in the future because they have been against the project right from the start. And I have slightly different views from Mr. Wong. My thought is that in the future, the opposition members are likely to use the XLL. So I invite the members of the public to remember these faces one by one, and when they go, when they board the trains, you should greet them one by one. Mr. Gary Fan said this morning that he might take the Mr. Charles Mok said he might take the train, obey reluctantly. So I hope the president can take the lead, so that the collocation bill can be passed as soon as possible. Dr. K.K. Kwok. Dr. K.K. Kwok. President, I need to talk about filibustering. In 2009 at LegCo, the government and the mainland authorities staged an act. They said that the government wanted to extend the XLL to the heart of Hong Kong, and there was a funding application in 2012, and we asked at that time whether co-location was needed, and Eva Chen said it was not necessary. And after that, well, who were the real filibusters? In 2014, they mentioned a budget overrun, and there were many engineering issues. And in the previous term of LegCo, they talked about a budget overrun. They could continue, but we asked what the clearance and collocation arrangements would be. Professor Anthony Chang did not answer the questions. Mr. Rimsky-Yun played deaf and did not answer either. And now at 2018, they accused us of filibustering. At the time, they already knew that they had to force the plans through. So who were the real filibusters? Who are the real culprits? Some members quoted what Mr. John Chang said about ladies and gentlemen at the council. You know, that was amazing, because we having a mud fight here. The same goes for members, the president, and government officials. And people who throw bombs around can become members and enter the EXCO, and they are now secretaries. Of course, they would support it, because with the XLL, they can continue to reap the benefits. Please come back to the discussion. President, you are in it together. This is a mud fight, and the government is just unacceptable. Yesterday, Carrie Lam showed her metal, and the loyalists asked about the property prices, but she would ignore them. She just wanted to fulfill her mission and report to the central government. Hong Kong people must wake up. So nothing is more important than a political mission. Some people might wonder what the relevance is because we're talking about co-location. If you think about it, why did Deng Xiaoping had to refer to the basic law after the 1989 movement? People were scared and people were fleeing. That's why Deng Xiaoping talked about the basic law and he made it clear that nothing could change. Jiang Zemin talked about separate policies for both places and the rules of China should not be copied in Hong Kong, which is why Hong Kong still survives, and that is why Hong Kong people would still invest in here. If Hong Kong adopts Article 23, all the capital would just vanish, and the officials, the mainland officials, would leave together with their money. You talked about a co-location arrangement between U.S. and Canada and between U.K. and France. You were just shameless because these you were talking about democratic countries. So I wish that we are talking to a democratic country. Is that the case in China? Can China be compared to those countries? So the children of the government officials are very smart. They all went to New Zealand and Australia. Well, many of your children are living overseas. So just stop already. You said that the NPC-SC decision is ultimate, and according to the Constitution, the people are the most important, the workers are important, but when you look at workers in the mainland, they have no right to gather to protest or to go on a strike. The people are always below the party. If the NPC members are going to be voted by one person, one vote, then you can start talking about countries like UK, US, and Germany, and we will certainly follow suit. We looked at cases of Liu Xiaobo, Liu Xiao, and Li Wangyang. They were just some scandals, and they were a cause for concern for Hong Kong people. You said young people are looking forward to the XLL, but I can tell you that Hong Kong has taken huge blows, and the young people were either disqualified or sent to jail. Please come back to the topic. These are why we cannot support the co-location arrangement. Many people said that the NPC and the NPC decision has the highest power, but the NPC decisions are what frustrate people time and again. The interpretation of law in 2004 meant that there were no dual universal suffrage in 2007 and 2008, and a five-step process was introduced. And the NPC decided whether we would have universal suffrage. Of course, the answer was no. And 10 years on, now at 2018, we could not even talk about it. And that was thanks to the NPCSC interpretation in 2016. Before we even hit the courts, people would be we would be disqualified. Members were disqualified. and they could not vote. Everyone went according to plan. Have some dignity. You should dig a hole for yourself. And for the Bay Area, when you talk about co-location, you talked about the Hong Kong Joint Macau Bridge and Bay Area. The purpose is to blur one country, two systems, and to blur the boundaries of Hong Kong, and to blur the identity of Hong Kong people. There is only one ultimate aim, and that is to implement one country, one system. For the main, this is not only detrimental to Hong Kong, but also to the mainland. When Deng Xiaoping promulgated the Basic Law, he knew that when everyone thought China would become more democratic and more accountable, they can be aligned after 50 years. But the current situation is even worse than the time when the Basic Law was promulgated, because it was a time of opening up. Many Chinese and Hong Kong people had the belief that the country was changing for the better.
Students who studied overseas would come back to contribute to the country, thinking that the economy would be better. But today, the level of corruption is much more serious. In the past, corrupt officials would not have billions and billions of dollars held in suitcases. And what has become this power? I think you have wandered too far. Come back to this debate. I know you want to evict me. If you evict all of us, it would be even easier for you. We are talking about the Basic Law. Who is following the Basic Law now? You have forgotten the Basic Law. Article 18 is stating that national laws shall not be applied in the Hong Kong SAR. This is why co-location is unconstitutional in our eyes. This is the basic principle. All officials like Frank Cheng, he is so complacent. But does he know anything about the rule of law? Where is he? Where is Eva Chang? Or actually, Theresa Chang. She should be here. She should be here to tell us why co-location is not unconstitutional. Why is she hiding? Mr. Frank Chen, he who knows nothing, is here to read scripts. And you are telling us that you have done everything. Use your brain. The DOJ officials were at the Bills Committee, but they were not answering questions. They just said it would be okay. Everything would be fine. They talked about proportionality, and then they said there was no general application. They were moving the goalposts. They were saying this and that from time to time. This is what they are good at. But this is so shameful. They would say, okay, if you don't like the law, take it to the courts. I expect you to do that. How can you say such things? And Mr. C.Y. Leung and some high officials in the DOJ say that we are abusing the court procedures. But now they are saying the opposite. They say, okay, if you don't like it, take it to the courts for judicial review. How can you say this? There are so many gaps and loopholes in this bill, and you don't think you should do a good job at the time of scrutiny, but you are trying to bulldoze everything through at the Bills Committee and in LegCo here, and then you say we can challenge you in the courts. How low have you sunk? You are not giving proper explanations. Dare you face Article 18? How can you say that you are following the Basic Law? Starting from 2009, you have given us a pack of lies. Hong Kong people should wake up. most cars or people would have to switch trains at Panyu and Shenzhen, and then you have to pay $200 odd just to go to Guangzhou. Only the crazy ones would take the train. Well, it doesn't matter because this is not a decision by Hong Kong people. There is another laughable thing. They say if you don't use the XLL, you don't need to mind the bill. Well, the laws of every type cover the entire territory. Does it mean that Hong Kong people don't have to mind the laws as long as they do not do certain things? How can you advance such an argument? You say if you don't go to the control point at WKS, this law will not apply to you. Does it mean people don't have to mind the stamp duty provisions if they don't buy property? You call this the rule of law? What kind of rule of law is this? You are moving the goalposts all the time. You are advancing non-legal concepts. And there are counselors and even professors of law here helping the administration. This council has a lot of brown nosers. Are there enough members here who will speak up for Hong Kong people? We are not really miserly with the 90-odd billion dollars. We know it's money down the drain. And also, we have seen derailment of trains on the mainland. Even if we give you the money to build a low-speed rail, we want to defend the basic law and one country, two systems. These two are more valuable than the railway. You are damaging the basic law and one country, two systems, and the harm, the damage is done. But you are just puppets. I would just say that I oppose this bill. Dr. Cheng Chung Tai. Hong Kong people object to co-location for a simple reason. Because our society has no place for mainland laws. The public think that there are no laws on the mainland, and the people cannot follow any laws because the laws change all the time. We can still remember 1989, and 3 years ago, there is this Causeway Bay bookstore incident. We question whether there are laws on the mainland. This accusation is such that, of course, there are laws and courts on the mainland. It is such. It is just that most of us think that the mainland courts are just serving the people in authority, that they are a political tool. In fact, they are serving the NPC. In other words, there are no checks and balances against the government on the mainland. This is why we need to expressly object to co-location and having an MPA in Hong Kong so that Hong Kong's jurisdiction is given up. It's like allowing the mainland to have your kidney. But other people, of course, may not agree. They say that this is not a kind of comprehensive understanding of the law. In the mainland, there are four levels of courts. We have the supreme, the high, and then the middle and basic people's courts, and then there are military courts from time to time. There are four levels of so-called people's court, but there is a basic principle in mainland courts, and that is when they judge on cases, they will not follow precedents, facts, submissions, and then make a judgment. Rather, every step must be taken according to the orders of a higher level of court. Well, you would say, this is a proper procedure, isn't it? No, it's not as simple as that. Because in the trial process, the judge is prejudiced. It is not just about the appointment system, but first, cases judged in mainland courts are such that there would be this trial committee before trial actually begins. The trial committee will decide before court opens whether there should be a conviction, and when the court opens, it is just for sentencing. To the defendant, we might think that there should be the benefit of the doubt and that everybody should be equal before the law. But this is not so on the mainland. And in the process, there would not be the opening of the case and then submissions and then a ruling. Actually, trial begins with a ruling. This is so different from Hong Kong. What is more complicated is that in the process, there will be two special persons. One, a people from the political branch, and then also a person from the party. Well, we just can't understand it. If collocation is passed, then at MPA, if there is any legal dispute, then Hong Kong people will have to face such a strange system while they are still in Hong Kong. We question this. We disagree with this. And you may say that I was just only briefing you on the legal system in China, but don't you always hear this? We will say at the court, what are the guiding principles? What are the core values of a people's court? But they talk about three supremacies. One, the party's interest. And they say they people's benefit, and then they will say the constitution. And you will, of course, understand that these three are contradictory to one another. But today, the mainland as we know it, don't put all these at the top. Not the party, not the constitution, not the people, but Xi Jinping. Shouldn't you be worried? Exactly because of this, well, let me explain why you are not worried. Think about this. If your father has the surname Jiang, shouldn't you be worried? Because it is not that the party rules supreme. And Hong Kong people, when you consider the establishment of MPA, you should object because it all boils down to the fact that Hong Kong society does not allow the operation of mainland laws here. Well, you might say that I am not comprehensive in my understanding. Now, of course, in the process of opening up and reform, the mainland society certainly gave us certain false hope. Otherwise, I would not be as naive as I was. I actually went to the Beijing Law School to read a law degree. I am a doctor in law. In 1990, there was this case that shook the entire legal community. It was said that the Chinese system would become a judicial system. This is the Chai Yiling case. Come back to this debate. President, I never ventured away from this debate. I have always been here. In that case, it was such that on the mainland, now we question the MPA and we think that you are setting the mainland against us. Okay, listen to this case, listen to the story, because we are quite bored. Tsai Yuling was in Shantong, she was a girl, and she had the chance to study. Please come back to the debate. All right, I won't tell the story. But this case was the first in Chinese history, and it was found that a rich person cheated somebody of $100,000, and the girl's identity was stolen by this rich person because the rich person wanted to study. This was the first case signaling the advance of the legal system in the mainland. That was in 1990. But then, since then, the courts of mainland cannot mention this case and the relevant discussion because it was too similar to the common law and statute law. I am reiterating here that in Hong Kong, we should not allow the application of mainland laws and the mainland legal system in Hong Kong. And President, I'm coming back to the point you love to hear. Many people said that there is no constitutional basis for co-location because you are depriving Hong Kong's jurisdiction in one area of Hong Kong. In the civil law of China, there is no judicial review. In other words, you do not have any recourse for challenging the government. And this is exactly the most important part of Hong Kong's rule of law, and I will supplement with facts here. Many pan-democrats, especially the Civic Party, emphasized time and again that in this bill, we see a contravention of the proportionality test in the Hong Kong legal system. This is a legal jargon, or it is a principle or a concept, but politically, you are talking about a very simple idea, and that is the government. Well, we are talking about the idea and existence of a limited government. The keyword is limited.
A limited government should be limited by the constitution and the power to hear judicial review cases is an important tool. Why is it related to proportionality test? In before 1800s, the government at that time was not subject to the monitoring of the court. However, later in 1976, Hong Kong became a signatory party of the ICCPR. So if the government of a country impose pressure on its government, then they should be restricted. And this should be done by local legislation. From 1976 to 1991, we have the Hong Kong Bill of Rights Ordinance. And the Hong Kong Bill of Rights Ordinance enshrined Hong Kong people's rights and the right to participate politically. And from that point onwards, we have judicial review, which is a proportionality principle. I hope you understand. I hope Hong Kong people will understand that this is not a legal jargon. The proportionality is that in 1991, the Court of Appeal used a Canadian case which talked about two legs of this principle. First is to check the policy and measures of the government to see whether it is constitutional. The second part is whether the law is reasonable, and the burden of proof lies on the government. So far, the administration has not told us how collocation is constitutional, so they have been flouting Hong Kong Bill of Rights Ordinance. And on this point, I'm sure I'll win if I take you to court, but I don't have the money. Well, for 8.1b, when this bill is passed, we don't even have the right for judicial review. The Hong Kong Bill of Rights was passed in 1991, but if this bill is passed, there is conflict of law. Don't you find it strange? 1999, the Chong Fong Yun case resulted in the NPCSC interpretation because two laws were conflicting, and today we don't have to do anything? And on these two points alone, I ask you to try to understand how come that in MPA, international laws don't apply. What will be the implication It means that there is a place in Hong Kong where you don't enjoy freedom of speech, where you don't enjoy any human rights protection, and you live in fear. It's just like the Causeway Bay bookstore incident. So what do we do? So I'm asking, what do we do? It's been shoved down our throat at the moment. Well, when we lose our rights in that place, we have been fighting for universal suffrage that stemmed from the Hong Kong BORO, and it covers the right to universal suffrage. It seems that the Hong Kong government has reneged on their own words. That was 1991, it's less than 25 years ago. Whose responsibility is it? Hong Kong people's responsibility, because we don't have vision. We're too stupid. That's why I can conclude that I believe that reasons for opposing the bill can be geographical delineation, there is ambiguity in our legal jurisdiction, and there is no legal basis. Well, there is actually one condition. If it is fulfilled, that we can accept this ludicrous collocation, is back to Article 22 of the Basic Law. Well, that means under Article 22, no department of Central People's Government and no province, autonomous region or municipality directly under the central government may interfere in the affairs which the Hong Kong SAR ministers on its own in accordance with this law. If there is an actual legislation, well, I'll call it for short anti-intervention law. I'm sure if it is legislated, our minds will be put at ease. I speak to oppose to the third reading. Professor Joseph Lee. Just now, Dr. Cheng Chung Tai has given us a good lecture of the law. Well, I don't expect to get a doctorate degree in the Faculty of Law. If I get an undergraduate degree, I would be very happy. Well, I'm no expert in law, and I have spoken in the Bills Committee, and some members said that Charles Mok, well, as said that he would take the XRL and the Democratic Party. I say that will bribe the XRL. Well, according to what Dr. Cheng said, that if I ride the XRL, I expect to lose my personal freedom, and Hong Kong and mainland laws apply, but I am in Hong Kong. That's very strange. According to Dr. Cheng Chung Tai, well, that means it is a place where it's been leased, not as a cession, but it's been leased to the mainland. So in this place, Hong Kong laws don't apply. I'm not going to repeat. Last time in the CSA, I have done some homework about the leased area, say for example in the French area, and also the government at that time, everything was chaotic. Well, I'm just trying to say that with co-location, it will give the effect that there is a piece of land that has been leased to another place, and there will be problems. We fully understand that at 10 o'clock we will vote, this will become the law. When this bill is passed, we will have a law that clearly says what is it, constitutional? What is the legal basis? What will be the implications? the Bar Association and the Secretary for Justice can't say clearly that there is a problem with this bill because it contravenes Article 18, 20, and 22. I'm not going to go into details because some other members have already covered that. In 45 minutes or so, or an hour or so, this bill will be carried. This is a piece of legislation that has conflicting legal basis, and it will be carried. What will happen? I've been a legislator for over 10 years. I have seen some poor laws that have been passed. They are poor in the sense that they are not in line of public interest in a civic society. So we call these bad laws. But I see that there is something different about this bad law, because when this is carried, our legal system will be undermined. It is not in line with the basic law. Well, some members said that this is a decision of the NPCSC. It has no legal basis. Well, I'm not from the legal sector, so I won't actually say that. But what I see is that it's a piece of legislation with very weak legal basis and a lot of legal points that have not been clarified. Well, the bill itself is very clear. This piece of land will be leased to another party. But what about rights and responsibilities in the legal sense of staff of mainland authorities? And there are also six blank areas in the form of reserved matters. These are all ambiguous because of a weak legal basis. If we allow this bill to be carried, wouldn't it be really strange? Our colleagues have spotted that and they have proposed amendments. They put forward the amendments. Some loyalists said that you have demonized it. But what I can see from these amendments is to choose the lesser of the two evils, because we can't stop the bill from being passed. What about we try to clarify the legal basis and make it less unconstitutional? Say, for example, we talk about expiry days, strengthening the human rights protections by the Hong Kong BORO. This is bad because of conflicting legal basis and ambiguities. And we can't try to improve it with our amendment, so I'm afraid we can't support the third reading. I'm not going to repeat about the point of law. I'm not going to go away. Another reason why I opposed to the third reading, well, I have read the basic law and the rules of procedure. There is clear stipulation of the legislature saying that a bill is introduced, it will go through a vigorous process before it becomes the law of Hong Kong that applies to Hong Kong. On this occasion, it's rather different. President, if I remember right, Article 72 of the Basic Law gives you power, which sounds to be supreme. Yes, we agree that president of the LegCo is an important figure. We agree with that. But when it comes to the rules of procedure for the legislative process from the first reading to the third reading, it's Rule 51 to 56. And in Rule 54, bracket 3, we see very clearly what the process should be involved in the second reading. Well, it says that members should be given sufficient time to talk about the merits, shortcomings of the bill. And then we move on to Rule 57 in relation to committee stage. Well, Chairman, you exercised your power. I have looked up the basic law. There may be one article that you can use. That is Article 76 bracket, says Article 70 bracket 6. That is, you may impose deadline. You can stop filibustering. Well, this is the third reading. And I was scared because when I pressed the button, I was a bit slow. I was, not the first 20 members. Luckily, I have a chance to speak. Yes, President, your good self may have supreme power. However, under the rules of procedure as well as Article 72, well, we have to. You should know that you need to follow the legislative process enshrined in this red book. You can't distort it. You can't compress it. You can't cut it out. Together with this bad law, how can I support a third reading to allow this law to be passed? And someone will say, just let it pass first. You may not like it. You can apply for judicial review. But I've heard from Dr. Cheng Chung Tai about this point. He explained about a constitutional point and about a limit. A restricted government. But it seems that he can't see how he will be able to exercise his right because of this weak legal basis of the bill.
There were plenty of controversies and the bill might be unconstitutional. So if the bill is passed, what will happen? Some people might say that this bill is very important and this would enable TXLL to operate. But as I said during the committee stage, today we are not actually talking about the pros and cons of the XLL. Some members said that after the passage of the bill, they would do something about the ticket prices, the stations, etc. The intention of the XLL is to connect Hong Kong with the mainland so that Hong Kong can connect to other transport systems in the mainland. This is one of the principles. However, this bill is not about the operation of the XLL. If boundaries are to be established under the bill, no checks and balances would be possible. And in the legislative process, by the time of the second and third readings, the president exercised his powers in setting limits and imposing restrictions and skew the rules. Given the circumstances, how can I be satisfied with the procedures? The government might say that after tonight, the third step would be completed and the proper procedures would be completed. So is the legislative process whole? Can you minimize the impacts on Hong Kong from the process? So hopefully the government can address that. That's why there's no reason I can support the third reading of the bill. Mr. James Ho. President, I wrote a lot to criticize how you presided over the meeting and how dictating you are and how you deprived the rights of members. But is this, or does this actually mean anything? I've been at the council for more than 20 years. I can say that I'm speaking with a heavy heart. I hope God can bless me so that I can make myself or my points clear. For other issues such as constitutional reform or legislating for Article 23, compared with the passage of this bill and the damage to one country, two systems, or indeed damage to Hong Kong and the nation, they are just incomparable. I just want to remain hopeful and hope that the Almighty God can change history and I hope the leader can rectify their decision eventually and make amends. In the second reading, I did not have the chance to speak. I would stop criticizing you here, even though I prepared a lot. I would now speak on why I'm against the third reading of the bill. President, there is an argument I did not mention before. So who is, which is the higher organ? Is it the NPC or NPCSC? I'm no expert in this, but from my basic understanding of China law, and according to mainland experts, and I'm seeking advice from mainland experts, I understand that the NPCSC promulgated or established the basic law. The NPC established the basic law, and the NPCSC made a decision. According to the SAR government, it was not an interpretation of the law. The NPC could interpret the laws because, according to mainland laws, the NPC can interpret the laws they made, including the basic law. I'm sure the government has consulted mainland experts and the authorities in the mainland before announcing that the NPCSC decision on co-location did not amount to interpretation of the law. The NPCSC can only interpret the laws but not amend them. The basic law made by the NPC stipulates that mainland laws shall not apply in Hong Kong. So for the cooperation arrangement approved by the NPCSC, can this decision contravene the provision under the basic law made by the NPC that no national laws shall be applied in Hong Kong? So this is a question of whether the NPC is higher or the NPCSC. This is not an issue Hong Kong needs to deal with. By passing this bill, we are approving the fact that the NPCSC decision can be higher than the NPC. But even if we err, we would only affect Hong Kong. But if the nation allows the NPC or the central government to instruct the SAR government, this is a higher constitutional issue. Would certain individuals from the central government be able to instruct the SAR government, and would the NPCSC decision override the NPC? So is the highest leader of the nation offering an instruction that the country should be ruled by law? The bill might be passed very soon. I just hope the highest leader can consider whether this is a rule by law. If, after careful consideration, they realize something is wrong, can they show the mettle and determination that no matter how much they have erred on Hong Kong issues, they should go back to ruling the country by law. If the bill is passed later tonight at LegCo, there would be four problems. Number one, if some people suspect that passing the bill would contravene the basic law, it is still being passed. And number two, LegCo might not be much in the constitution of the country. And the MPCSC decision would be above the basic law made by the MPC. And the SAR government would jeopardize confidence from the international community in one country, two systems. If the NPCSC decision is made part of the Hong Kong laws, LegCo would be introducing a new practice for the basic law so that an organ outside of Hong Kong can legislate for Hong Kong in some way. President, on a more macro perspective view, one country, two systems is not just designed for Hong Kong. It is to demonstrate that China is marching towards civilization, and people are made to believe that we are progressing to the basic law and the implementation of one country, two systems. Mr. Deng Xiaoping hoped that our Taiwanese comrades would consider peaceful reunification under the premises. If we pass this bill tonight, to implement mainland laws in some parts of Hong Kong in breach of the basic law, there would be 10 negative impacts, and I must say these tonight. First, this is in breach of the basic law in one country, two systems. Number two, jeopardizing Hong Kong's rule of law, the implementation of the common law, and it would affect the image of the legal system in Hong Kong. And number three, further to these, to the two above points, Hong Kong's status as international financial center would be affected. Number four, based on the 3 points above, Hong Kong's status as international arbitration center would be affected. Number five, in turn, affecting the implementation of the Belt and Road Initiative, contradicting the China dream promulgated by the current leader. Number six, the basic law's role and justification as for unification with China would be affected, and the confidence of the Taiwanese people will be affected. Number seven, the international community will further doubt the implementation of one country, two systems, and they would sympathize with the separatism and independence of Taiwan. And number eight, the international community would have the basis to sympathize or support certain people in Hong Kong who promote Hong Kong independence, and there would be further risk of Hong Kong independence. Number nine, the international community would doubt whether China would confirm or deal with international agreements, and they would have doubts on Hong Kong's or China's national policies. And number 10, with the international developments and the relations with the U.S. If one country, two systems is being doubted, which affects the, or tarnish the reputation of China. China would be put in a in an unfavorable position in international relations, especially with the U.S. President. Not many members might understand such strategic discussions. Well, if you do not understand, if you do not agree with me, it's fine, but at least you should understand what I'm saying. If those in power in China understand what I said, I would have fulfilled my role as a lawmaker in Hong Kong who is concerned with the development of the country. President, if God takes me back tonight, I would do so gladly because I would have fulfilled my duty. To make clear the drawbacks of passing this bill. Mrs. Regina Yip.
Thank you, President. I speak on behalf of the New People's Party to support the third reading of the co-location bill. I have served in LegCo for 10 years. Indeed, I witnessed the construction of XRL and also the completion of this mammoth project, including the legislative work for it. We are in the last mile. Of course, there is still subsidiary legislation and part of the project has to be completed. And Mr. Secretary, as long as the railway projects won't derail, we expect to be able to take the XRL to the mainland in September. This bill is full of controversy indeed. As some members said, and I remember very clearly, 8 years ago, in 2010, in January of that year, Ms. Eva Chang, STH, came to the Finance Committee to apply for funding. The old LegCo building was besieged. We were cut off, and young people were kneeling when they besieged LegCo, and maybe it included Mr. Eddie Chu, and they said that they would have to protect the villagers and the elderly because a village had to be demolished for building the XRL, and there were some disputes with regard to compensation. But through the efforts of the mainland and also SARG over the past 10 years, we are now near the destination. Just now, many members painted a negative picture of co-location, and they said that this is illegal, this is unconstitutional. This is a very negative description. I find this most regrettable. They say this will affect one country, two systems. I think they are harboring a lot of prejudice or even discrimination against the mainland. And in fact, there is even hostility towards the mainland. It goes to show that many colleagues are very short-sighted. They are just like a frog in a well. Mr. Eddie Chu said, for example, you have to give your real name to buy a ticket. He said it's unprecedented and it flouts our privacy. But we are in the digital era. Whether you go to Amazon, Facebook, or Google, your personal information is collected. You use your smartphone to do online shopping, your digital trail is already recorded. Don't you know that the entire globe is developing fintech, e-payment, P2P lending? Mr. Eddie Chu only showed his own ignorance. We should know that the future world is a world of technology, a world of integration. XLR represents future technology. It will take Hong Kong to a bigger world and an integrated country. When our colleagues object to the bill, it only goes to show that they are narrow-minded and short-sighted. As for economic benefits, I don't think we should dwell on whether there would be a profit of $90 billion to cover the cost. I think in terms of economic benefit, we should not just look at IRR. We should look at the long-term benefit of XLR. I don't think any economist can make an accurate projection, but I have heard people of all trades and industries, whether they work at Disney theme park or the cruise terminal, and it's not just Mr. Yu Si Wing, who are saying that hopefully the XLR and the construction of other ports will help Hong Kong open up different channels for China to go global. Well, people say Hong Kong is not an XLR hub. I admit that. How can we be? People who have been to WKS would know that it is a grand station, but compared to Shenzhen North and Guangzhou South stations, which are as big as airports, we cannot compare with those. But if we have co-location, we can enhance Hong Kong's status as a transport hub. If co-location takes place in Futian, then people of Chinese origin who come from the south, some from Southeast Asia, if they want to take XLR to Hangzhou, they may fly directly to Futian, and we will miss these tourists. So you should not be so shallow in your view, saying that the $90 billion have gone down the drain. You should be looking more into the future. Secretary, remember, your rail cannot derail. I hope that in 1 year, the XLR will link us up with the mainland so that there will be economic benefit and convenience. And there is a bright future. And as to whether co-location is unconstitutional, Mr. President, I don't have any legal qualification and I should not be speaking on this point and whether it flouts Article 18 of the Basic Law, but I was the chairman of the Bills Committee. I chaired 45 hours of meeting in 3 months and also 18 hours of public hearings. I heard too much about the accusation that co-location is unconstitutional. And I have also heard the administration many times. Last week, when I reported on behalf of the Bills Committee, I already repeated what the administration said, and I would now only make a few points. The administration explained in detail whether it was the Solicitor General, Mr. Wesley Wong, or Ms. Theresa Chang. It is said that this will not amount to bills or laws like national emblem or national anthem, which are national laws, and if they are included in Annex 3, they would apply to everybody in Hong Kong. But we are not talking about this type of laws that will be implemented at WKS. They are for a particular objective, and that is to implement the co-location policy. And it will only apply to people who use WKS only. Therefore, Article 18 is not engaged. But people say, you're not a lawyer, you're not qualified. But I'm only repeating what the lawyers said. I am repeating what government counsel said. They repeated their explanation. And here we have many legal experts here, and this is really repeated to the extent of ad nauseum. It is only that people choose not to listen. And in fact, opposition camp, we have given you enough time to voice your dissatisfaction at the Bills Committee. I remember at the hearing, Mr. Philip Dykes, the chairman of the Bar Association, came and you took turns in to ask him questions so that he was able to voice his opposition. And then government counsel responded to all of those. Therefore, you cannot say that the administration did not respond to the question of constitutionality. It's just that you did not accept the responses. And the basic discrepancies cannot be resolved tonight or at the Bills Committee. Of course, I'm not encouraging the public to seek a judicial review lightly, but this legal issue, if indeed someone would instigate JR, will have to be dealt with at the court. These opposition camp are speaking on camera. They know that they are supported by people outside, and they are proposing that what they believe in is the absolute truth, and they are spreading fear in society. They are saying that mainland security officials are to be feared. If that's the case, why is it that 500,000 people are going to the mainland every day to live, work, and for leisure? This is very unfair to the co-location arrangement, and this is most misleading. I will speak here in order to set the record straight. Thank you, Mr. Abraham Shack.
Mr. President, I'd like to make a declaration, although it has nothing to do with this bill. I'm a director and ED of MTR. President, before I start my speech today, I'd like to acknowledge your tolerance, patience in putting up with the disorderly behavior during the past 2 days. History will be kind to you. Mr. President, I have listened intensely to what my honorable colleagues from the opposite side have said in this heated debate. In their speeches, particularly Yang Ok-kyu and To Gan San, they remind me of the speeches that was delivered in the old chamber before the July 1st, 1997. Their fears that they talk about have yet to materialize. And today, the opposition parties talk about the same fears. In the next 30 to 50 years, they will also not be materialized. In their speeches, and in my view, it all boils down to a difference in the reading of the good intentions of the Chinese authorities on Hong Kong SAR. Let me remind them and ourselves of how the Hong Kong SAR has come about in the first place. The great leader, Deng Xiaoping, engineered the one country, two system to entrust Hong Kong people with a high degree of autonomy to administer the special administrative zone region. This innovative guiding framework is now enshrined in the basic law that everybody talks about. And it is this basic law that we all sworn by to protect it and follow it. What is the basic law? The basic law sets aside an entire chapter to safeguard our fundamental rights. It allows, as what Dennis Kong was talking earlier, International Convention on Civil and Political Rights, the International Convention of Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, as well as the International Labour Conventions to remain in force in Hong Kong. It says our rights and freedoms should not be restricted unless as prescribed by law. These provisions in the mini constitution are further fortified by a piece of local legislation in the form of a Bill of Rights, which is wrongly interpreted by some of my colleagues just now. The Chinese authorities have bent over backwards to set our heart at ease. This unification mechanism has worked, and there was no reason then for the mainland to undermine our way of life. China does not just talk the talk, she walks the walk. There is no reason then and now for her to eat into our rights and freedom in the pretext of this co-location bill. People in Hong Kong, China, and the world at large are living in an era of unprecedented changes at an unprecedented rate. We can ill afford to be complacent in the face of challenges and opportunities, particularly for our young people. We in Hong Kong in particular has a lot of soul searching to do. As our motherland matures into a social, economic, and political power of worldwide recognition, Beijing has come up with visionary development strategies such as the Belt and Road and Greater Bay Area, to which some of our opposition members visited. The rest of the world is eager to jump on these bandwagons of prosperity and stability. Hong Kong does not have the luxury to sit on our hands and start to accuse our motherland of insincerity. The Hong Kong section of the Hong Kong Shenzhen Guangdong Express Rail Link is a tangible step for us to literally get on board. Co-location of boundary control is a prerequisite. At no time is this co-location bill rammed down our throats. It is not as unconstitutional as it being said. The Standing Committee of the National People Congress has given its stamp of approval only after the Hong Kong SAR government have reached voluntary agreement with its counterpart in Guangdong. It is now up to this assembly, the third step, to enact the proposed arrangement into local law. This three-step flow is due process in action and is thoroughly legal. Over the past two decades, the Central People's Government have worked with the HKSAR with trust and respect. And mind you, trust and respect is a two-way street. We must not reciprocate those good intentions on the part of the motherland with undue skepticism and contempt. Compared with 1997, as many of our opposition colleagues have feared, I can say, hand on heart, that we are in a much better position to place even greater confidence in our sovereign power. The fact remains that vast majority of us are convinced that this bill is the way forward. We want this bill. We need this bill. And I urge the opposition side that do away with your fear, for there's nothing to fear except fear itself. So try to work out something, because Hong Kong is our home. We need to have mutual faith and trust with our motherland. With this word, I support the motion, and I speak on behalf of BPA. Thank you, Mr. President.
是否有其他議員想發言?
Does any other member wish to speak? Will the official reply? Secretary. Mr. President, first of all, I thank all of you for allowing me to speak in a quiet and calm atmosphere. In relation to the Hong Kong section of the Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Express Rail Link, as well as the advantage of co-location, its long-term contribution to Hong Kong, they are undeniable. I believe that you all understand deep in your heart what it is all about. I don't have to repeat it. I only have two things to say in relation to the third reading. First, uphold the basic law. Uphold one country, two systems. It's not the privilege of a handful of people. The Hong Kong SAR government and the central authorities respect the PRC constitution, the principle of one country, two system, the basic law, much more so than the opposition. We are more committed, we are more determined. Two, in relation to the fears and concerns of the bill, it boils down to one thing: difference in opinion and maybe a difference in trust and faith. You can't change your faith easily, but we can try to trust each other. I ask you to open your heart to try to understand the collocation arrangement. I believe that time will tell. Lastly, I ask members to turn to their conscience to vote to support this bill. I so submit. I now propose the question to you that the Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Express Rail Link Collocation Bill be read a third time and do pass. Mr. Gary Chen claims the division. The bell will be rung for 5 minutes. Thank you.
開始表決。
Voting begins. Please check your votes. If there are no questions, voting closes, result displayed. 62 present, 44, 20 against, 1 abstention. The question is agreed by majority of members present. I declare the motion passed. Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Express Rail Link Collocation Bill. Meeting is adjourned and to assume on the 20th of June, Wednesday at 11 o'clock.